The wind office Shannon slept hard at their backs, pushing the craft toward shore. Then, as the wind died away, the air of the water gave way to the air of land. Like opening a door to a room kept closed, Ireland met her with its fog and damp, the oily residue of burning turf, its rotting centuries, the air of her childhood. When the craft finally knocked against the landing stone, the man gave her a nod. "Shane, Gramayagat," she said in turn as she climbed from the ungainly moat. Thanks indeed, for he had saved her from traveling 50 miles overland or more. She gazed up the length of Market Street. Not a soul on the street. The town is empty as Good Friday afternoon. She should try to enjoy it. Once she fetched her cousins, precious little silence would remain, and it wasn't only silence the children would consume. On the long train ride from Chicago to New York, and again on the ship crossing over to Ireland, she'd made calculations. What had once fed three must now stretch to seven. Jesus, with his bountiful loaves and fishes, might be able to escape the limitations of arithmetic, dollars and cents divided by number of mouths, but others could not.